from Warsenal Studio B in Chandler, Arizona, this is MayaCast.
Welcome to another edition of MayaCast. I am your host, Tom Shadle.
I'm your host, Kip Parcell.
And this is episode 163 for Friday, January 5th, 2018.
What?
Happy Druze Year!
Yay!
Coming up on today's show, we will talk about what we've been doing since we've been away. We have the winners of the MayaCast MasterGlass Quarter 4 Fall painting competition. And the bulk of the show, we're going to talk about that brand new hotness that's out there, the Druze Bayram Security Sectorial that came out and that everybody's so excited for and all the distributors are out of models for and all that good stuff. But first, we do have a new event to announce. And this event comes to us from Konstantinos Lamprou. Sorry about that. Infinity at CanCon 2018, the Saraswati Affair.
That sounds interesting.
Will be a mixed format catering to both new and experienced players, so everyone can get the most out of the premier Infinity tournament of the year. This is also an Infinity satellite tournament, giving the winner an automatic place at the Interplanetario. This is going to be in Australia from the 26th to the 28th of January, 2018. And, yeah, that looks like as specific as he gets. Australia.
We'll see.
As Kip would say, the Australia area.
Yeah.
If you're in the Australia area.
And you have to remember, if you're in the Australia area, that the CanCon is the Gen Con of CanCon.
And in 2018, there's going to be two sub-events. The regular two-day, five-game standard ITS tournament on Saturday that's going to go from 9 to 5, and on Sunday from 9 to 3 to determine the Australian champion.
Nice.
That's the satellite tournament. Missions for that will be capture and protect, the grid, power pack, acquisition, and highly classified. Then there's an evening-only three-game casual narrative event on Friday from 6 to 10 p.m. and Saturday from 6 to 8 p.m., evening focused on fun narrative missions. Both the ITS tournament and the narrative event have a backstory linking them together as well as the missions with each other. Players can choose to attend either or both. We will have links to it in the show notes. And they want to thank all their sponsors, including Corvus Belly Toy Soldiers Imports, Bandua, Broken Egg, Black Sheep, Secret Weapon, Game Mad EU, Urban Mats, LOS Block, Micro Art Studio, Battle Kiwi, oh my god, there's more. Custom Meeple, Jackal Laser Designs, Warsenal, Aetherworks, Powered Play, Knights of Dice, Miniature Scenery, Plastcraft Games. So, if you're in the Australia area at the end of the month, 26th, through 28th of January 2018, you can attend the Gen Con of CanCon. CanCon.
Oh, man. I would love the opportunity to actually go to that. That'd be fun, because I've never been to the Australia area of the world.
It's already tomorrow there. They live in the future.
Yeah, I know. It's crazy.
No wonder Infinity's popular. So, yeah. And so that's the new event we have to announce. There's also events happening all the time and all over the place. So make sure you check out the show notes where we leave the links for past events that we've noticed. And if you want to have your event promoted on the show, just send an email to tom@mayacast.com.
And kip@mayacast.com.
And especially the first one. And we'll get that.
I've been better lately.
Read on the show and then post in the show notes so people can find your event. So, Kippers.
What's up, Tom?
It's been 2 weeks since we had an episode. It's been the holidays, so mm-hmm. I'm sure that's mostly what people have been up to. But what have you been doing for the last 2 weeks?
Catching up on life. So, and this does directly affect my hobby. Last time we recorded, I had said that there's been some crazy changes. And as you know, Tom, and anybody that's on Facebook knew, I am going to be a dad come July. So that is very exciting news. That was the majority of my holidays, was telling family and friends. Tom knew first because we spent a lot of time together and I needed to tell somebody and talk about it. So it's been like a secret for the last 3 weeks. Super exciting. But I started moving my hobby room out of my hobby room. Luckily, I get I get to the den, which I wanted in the first place, but I just don't get to hang as many cool nerd pictures up. But yeah, my hobby room is going to be a baby room, but it also affects Gen Con because the little thing, because I don't know if it's a boy or girl yet, will be born like right around Gen Con. So I'm going to have to miss that this year. So that was another like life event that's going to hold me from traveling. So I was a little bit like,
well, congratulations, Kip.
Yay.
I know you got to be a little freaked out, but you will be a great dad. You're very thoughtful and kind, and you're really good training your dogs.
So true, right?
Yeah.
Your cat.
Going to be an amazing dad, and congratulations. And so around Gen Con, that's when the podcast ends?
No. So, hey, so that's
when Willett takes over full time?
Seriously. Okay, so this happened. This conversation happened, right? Kenzie's like, so once the baby's here, is like the Mondays and the Wednesdays going to be a regular thing? And Willett, I used you as an example. I was like, hey, those are my days that are, you know, basically part of my life and secondary job. I actually treat it as like a secondary job, right? And I was like, Willett just had a baby and they're about to have another one. And he goes to more Mondays than I do, and he's still allowed to jump on the podcast every now and then. So that's just something we're going to have to work around. And she goes, okay, that's fair. So I already got it, and I should have recorded it. I should have recorded it so that I had it in voice writing. But no, it will not affect the show at all. It'll just be fun. Maybe every once in a while I'll have to bring the little thing in, and you can hear it in the background crying. Not really.
Okay.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, so that seems big.
Super, super.
Nothing big for me. Just been like Monday night, you know, it was New Year's Day.
Yeah.
And so we had a small crowd and we didn't play Infinity, but all of us played Aristeia instead. So that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Remains a very, very fun game. Mm-hmm. And as the people get more familiar with what's on the cards and don't have to read it over and over and over again during the game, the mm-hmm. games will speed up and get faster and get even more fun. But
Kip.
So
play Aristeia.
So I think it was Ben from New Mexico who pointed it out to me. He, you know, because we talked about the map being the same, just one side's red, one side's blue.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, slightly different.
Really?
The map is the same, but they've rotated the deployment zones around.
Oh, okay. So it is different.
So, like, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
It's exactly the same map, except now what used to be number 3 is now number 1 or whatever.
Oh,
right?
Okay.
They just sort of rotate around the board a little bit. Haven't given much thought to how, if at all, that matters, but,
maybe certain missions.
There is a difference. He found a difference.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that. But the other thing, so every once in a while, cause like we play, right?
Yeah.
And we've all read the rules and we played enough where, you know, we pretty much know what's happening. And then you look mm-hmm. up the occasional thing on the wiki, use the hot link off of Mayanet or Army. You know, to check something out. Oh, but what about when this does this? And then you look it up and you figure it out, right?
Yeah,
on
like
game
rules.
Night.
Mm-hmm.
But every so often, I like to sit down with ye old rule book. Well, actually, my iPad with
okay.
the PDF because it's
easier
much
that way.
Easier yeah. to hold. Sit down and start and read the rules again from the beginning, and read all the way through them, and it's really good because you. You find things, even if it's a super rare corner case, you find things mm-hmm. that you're like, wow, I don't think we ever knew that. And every time I read through the rules again, I find another thing that I'm like, oh, whoops. Or like,
yeah,
right? And,
pretty much.
And so Yeah, with my free time in the evening, like after my wife goes to bed or whatever. Mm. So like, you know, usually you might sit there and like throw on some show on Netflix or something. Mm-hmm. Right. Like I got all the way through Doctor Who in time for the Christmas episode. And and now then I find out that I have to wait till fall for the new season to start. And so instead of like, sit there and reading through the rule book again and finding all sorts of new and interesting things, even if they're really tiny, mm-hmm. Or very rare, but and little things that you forget because they're mentioned once and it's not emphasized and it's rare, like suppression fire.
Yeah.
The part we remember, this is just one example, right?
Okay.
And like for you reading through the rules, you might find something else, like you might be like, well, of course that's the thing, but then you'll see something else and be like, oh my God, this is a thing. And then other people will be like, of course that's a thing, because mm-hmm. we all remember different things different ways. So going through, reading through the rules, suppression fire, we all know that if you declare an order mm-hmm. or an ARO other than ballistic skill attack using the suppression fire state, mm-hmm. that you're out of suppression fire. You fail a guts roll, you're out of suppression fire. All mm-hmm. that. Remember those things. You also are out of suppression fire if you enter the retreat state or loss of lieutenant state.
See, the loss of lieutenant, I totally overlooked.
Yeah, it's just one of those little things. It's one little line that's in there, and it doesn't come up all that often. Or that I remember, right? But I was like, oh, I don't think I would remember to remove those states.
Yeah, I wouldn't. I definitely wouldn't.
So little things like that, little gems that you find. That's one example that for me was like a, whoa, what the? And again, you're probably out there like, well, duh, yeah, of course it is, because you remember that one. But there's probably something 2 pages later that you're like, oh. I know a lot of our, you know, a lot of, we run into people getting the falling rules wrong a lot, or we get them mm-hmm. right. And, you know, so it, maybe it's something like that, but
yeah.
Always kind of a good like pastime, maybe for bathroom reading, go through the rule book front to back, read all of it again, and, catch all those little things that you're like, oh yeah, we're not doing it that way. Whoops. Cause it's a very complex game and there's a lot of depth to it. Which is what I like, but it also gives the opportunity to miss subtle little things like that.
Yeah, I do that actually a lot in the, we'll say free time, and pull it up on my iBooks, and I consistently find that I'm like, oh my gosh, I misread that. I am an idiot. That's why that tagline is on me.
All right, well, you've probably seen it. Go up on Facebook, our gallery of all the Q4 MayaCast MasterGlass entries, mm-hmm. and entrants and viewers alike might be wanting to know who is the winner, and even more importantly, what is the theme for Q1 of 2018? So let's tell them.
Ladies and gentlemen, the MayaCast Masterclass.
So, everybody did an excellent job, as always. And there's a whole bunch, like, we could talk about every single one.
Right.
And the theme and everything else, and all the great paint jobs. We had 25 entries. And so, I'm sure the holidays, you know, made some people have to miss because they were too busy.
Yeah.
And perhaps our esoteric theme of just fall may have, maybe
people
want us to be really specific.
Yeah.
Paint a light infantry. Oh, that I can do. we had 25 entries and,
actually want to interject real quick, Tom. I did want to say that I was worried about people actually following the theme, but I was extremely impressed. I think that we got a lot of entries where you could look at them and it followed the rules. And I just wanted to give kudos to all of the entries, because I think that, you know, pretty much we'll say 99.9% of them, if you looked at them, you'd be like, oh, that I could see exactly what they were going for, you know? So I just wanted to say that before we get into everything.
For sure. And, so how should we do, should we do the random prizes first, or should we just announce the winners first and go from, let's announce the winners.
I think we should do the winners, 'cause it's something super unique. Like, we did a unique theme and it came out to be something that we've never done before.
So. Right. And, you may have heard the context clue when I said winners.
Yeah.
Because for the first time we are going to have co-champions, for the MayaCast MasterGlass. So for quarter four of 2018, mm-hmm. there are going to be two winners that each receive a MasterGlass. And theme definitely played an important role,
mm-hmm.
as well as quality of paint job. And so we have two winners. The first one
is one of my... It caught my eye that... Oh, man, this is why we have two. I can't say the most, but it's one of the ones that caught my eye, like, right away. I loved the contrast between the yellows and blues, and you can definitely tell that the fall was in there. And this is going to be, is that Joachim? How do you say that?
Sure.
Okay. I can't read the last name.
Forsberger.
Yeah, and this is for the, I apologize for totally... screwing your name up, but this was the intruder that had shot down the Garuda, like in the Nomad Temple, and it's like blown up the base and it's crash landed. And I like how the intruder is kind of like in the dark, and then the Garuda is like crashing down into the light side of the base. But it was amazing. The paint job's really, really good, and the theme was on freaking point. So congratulations for being co-champion next to...
So that Joachim Forsberg or Joachim Forsberg, or he'll let us know how.
I said burger.
You did.
And we just had dinner. This is ridiculous.
We did not have burgers.
No. Sounds like something you'd say when you're hungry.
Joachim Forsberg. And then our other co-champion, bringing the theme portion of the contest, turning it up to 11... Our other co-champion is Tor Swanson, and he had the excellent test run diorama with
right.
remotes falling off the roof of a building, and the little spring off the mule bot with the spring.
Yeah, the spring was an amazing touch.
And the fall-colored tree,
mm-hmm.
and the fall of gentlemanly good conduct. Represented by the test run jumping
yep.
off, and
there was a lot of fall going on in this.
All one. Of the posters falling down, but not mm-hmm. just falling down, like falling down on a Japanese or Chinese poster.
Mm-hmm.
What were so I'm not they looking have, at it right now, a, so I'm trying to remember.
They had a poster from Fallout that was Gravity Falls, the video game.
Gravity Falls. Yeah. They had a Fallout Boy poster.
Fallout Boy. They had Evanescence.
Fallen Out. Was the album called Fallen?
I think it's Fallen. Yeah.
They had Legends of the Fall mm-hmm. was one of the posters.
Free Fallen, Tom Petty.
Tom Petty. So the fall was strong with this one.
Yeah, the fall was definitely strong with this one.
And so, co-champions, each receiving their personalized MayaCast MasterGlass for 2018. Tor Swanson and Joachim Forsberg.
And cheer the yay! I could hear everybody cheering in the background.
I apologize if we're mispronouncing your name, yeah, Mr. Forsberg. And so, but so many honorable mentions.
Yeah.
So Bryant Vikshinarong did an excellent Tikbalang, and it's got he's just been monofilamented by, I imagine, because it's Bryant, that it's Shinobu. he called it Pride Cometh Before the Fall.
Mm.
And the like, as soon as he said it to me, I was like, that just got monofilamented, didn't it? Had that line right through the chest, the glowing metal. So that was really cool.
Yeah, that's pretty badass.
Casey painted an excellent Guijia.
Yeah, the paint job on that was really good, Casey. I want to tell you that much. That was definitely in the top five.
Really, really good. And if you enjoyed that, Grigia, he's still working on it. Now that the contest has gone up, now he's taken that clean paint job and he's adding like scratches and battle damage and dirt and stuff to it.
Oh, nice.
So you can, I think it was in WGC where I saw it. Mm. So you can go to Facebook and check out his updated pictures. Really cool diorama between Mushashi and the Oyorai pilot that was sort of repurposed into a ninja.
Yeah, I like that. that base was amazing. That was another top five for me. Definitely like the fall theme on Mushashi. I still can't believe that that's how it's spelled. And water effects, super, totally reminds me of an anime scene. So knocked it out of the freaking park on that one.
Gus's dragon lady walking through the fall leaves forest.
So pretty. I want to compliment your photography skills too, sir. I mean, look at this. I don't even drink during a show. I can't enunciate anything. the one picture I think actually Tor went on and was like, this is my favorite photo. Looks like it could be a little print. Like the really close up in the middle of the trees. Again, knocked out of the park, man. That was a
really great color scheme, really beautiful tones. Mm. Hakan sent us a Knauf on top of a tall sniper tower with this little computer, you know, and one bullet can take down the hyperpower.
Yep.
or even the hyperpower can fall.
Yes.
And Knauf was in fall colors as well. That was really good. Matthew Akins sent us a headless horseman model. It was the Newmark of the Ur hegemony.
Yeah. I still think that it cracks me up.
Holding a skull in its hand and then having no head. I thought that was great.
That was a good one. It cracks me up. But every time, like, I was like, Tom, what was the full name of that? The Newmark of the Ur hegemony. I can't even say it. Say it again.
The Newmark of the Ur hegemony.
It just cracks me up. I don't know.
Ur.
the title of that model just cracks me up. I can't say it with a straight face.
Yeah, you called it something like not even in faction.
No.
It was bad.
It was a left term that I used.
I love Travis's Bashi Bazook. If you look really closely, the face is painted like it looks like Scarecrow from Wizard of Oz.
Yeah, it was pretty good.
It's got the black nose and the tan.
The one falling on a pumpkin?
Yes.
Yeah.
Tactical pumpkin.
Tactical pumpkin.
That's what he wrote in the email. I remember that.
Oh, that's so good.
And on and on and on. Everybody did a great job. Make sure you go to Facebook. It's pinned at the top of our MayaCast page on Facebook. So head on over there. Check out all the entries. They're really great. Everybody did a great job. And so we do have two... We're giving away two blister packs to people that entered to random entrants. And instead of random.org, we used random.gen.
Yeah.
That's so good. I called out to my wife. I said, pick a number between 1 and 25. Now pick another one. And then we counted down. The first Wyndham, and any winner of a random blister, any blister in the affinity range that you like, that's going to be the gentleman who painted Go-Go Marlene and her fall-colored little microphone bot, the little rabbit guy.
Mm-hmm.
And that is Dave Cooper.
Congrats, Dave. And you can thank random.gen.
Yeah.
and the other one was really happy when she yelled out, 16! Because that was...
She doesn't even sound like that. Come on.
I know, my bad. Was Florian Stitz random blister for his Major Luna.
With the excellent freehand on the inside of the cloak.
Exactly. It was one of my favorites. Couldn't beat out Torin, Joachim. But congrats, guys.
Yeah, so Tor, Joachim, please get in touch with us with your shipping address as well as what you would like your glass to say. Most people go with their name. But right. Let us know so we have the proper spelling and it says exactly what you want. And you can let us know whether you'd like a pint glass or a highball glass.
Mm-hmm.
And we will get those for you. Meanwhile, Florian and Dave, let us know your shipping address and which blister pack you would like to receive from the Infinity Range. And as long as the distributors have it in stock, we will get that to you as soon as possible.
It's been a hard thing lately.
Yeah, so, yeah, hard to find, like, Hunzikutes and Saito Togan. And
that's what I'm saying. Yeah. not Infinity in general, but when you go and you're like, how the heck is everybody sold out of Camille's? I never thought there would be such a day where you couldn't find a freaking box of
Camille
drone bots.
So, it's okay. You'll be okay.
I'm throwing a paperclip right now.
And you know what? I had a box and I gave it to Dr. Dactyl Dave.
F you, Dactyl!
Once upon a time. And so, he's probably never built them. And
I need them.
And to let us know, you just email Tom at MayaCast.com.
And Kip at IamAnIdiot.com.
That's probably not going to work, so
no,
don't
send... Kip at MayaCast.com.
Somebody will get an email. And we will get those prizes out to you. Congratulations to everybody who entered. Now, you're probably wondering, whether you entered or not, you're probably wondering, hey, what is in store for quarter one of 2018? Because that's begun already.
Yeah, but I think you guys are going to be excited for this one, because I was excited for this one.
Yeah, and the due date will be the end of March. And in fact, the end of March happens on a weekend, so you're actually going to have until April 2nd to get those entries in, because that's when I will open my email. But yeah, so you've got that whole weekend to get them in, so April 2nd is the technical due date, and we're not super strict on those anyway, but so that's going to be the due date.
Mm-hmm.
The format to submit entries is we will require a before picture, which is unpainted, right? And if you've already built and primed something that you want to enter, that's fine, as long as you haven't started painting it yet. But it'll need the date attached to it so that we can see that it's new for the contest, because the idea is we want to generate new painted models every quarter. And so when you get it all painted up, then you can take up to four... completed pictures of it, and send the four completed pictures and the before picture all in one email. We don't want the before pictures first and the other ones later. We just want it all in one email. For the completed pictures, please rename them with your name. And that's what's going to appear on Facebook when you enter. So if you title your picture Florian Stitz, that's going to come up in the gallery as Florian Stitz. But yeah, so just name, you know, Florian Stitz 1, Florian Stitz 2, Florian Stitz 3, Florian Stitz 4. Yeah. And that will be the naming convention for the photos that we like to use. And that's how you enter the contest. So you got 3 months and the theme.
I was going to say, I can't wait till you tell them the theme, Tom.
The theme for quarter one 2018 is Druze Bayram Society. Security.
Security, yeah. Security, get this guy.
The Druze, yeah. So, Druze, that is the theme. Does that mean you have to paint a Druze model? No! Any model that is part of the brand new Druze Bayram Security Sectorial Army is valid.
Nice.
And so, it doesn't have to be a single model.
There you go.
If you want to paint a full fire team of five Druze, you can do that. If you would like to do Scarface and Cordelia, you can do that. If you want to paint your entire 300-point army and share that, you could do that as well. It is a maximum of 4 pictures per person, though, and it is a painting contest. So choose wisely to how you're going to show off your skill to the best of your ability. But anything in that sectorial is fair game, whether it's one model or 15 models.
Or a large. And you know what, Tom? I would like, this might be throwing it out there, it's a little stretch goal. I would like to see us get to 100 entries, because, you know, we do give out participations. So if we can get 100 or more entries, I think we should do something special. Not going to tell you what it is.
Yeah, I think we did. I think we had 125 in quarter three.
Yeah,
120 something.
So I think. Do you think that's good enough, or should we go?
Yeah. So anything from the Druze Bayram security sectorial, and so it's fairly open. You can do as much or as little as you like. Quantity will not matter in the judging, only quality. And we want them to be like Drew's theme, though, right? Like,
yeah.
Even though they can take a Fugazi, which is a pano remote, unless your Druze color scheme is blue, like we want it, like
Your merc scheme
should be Druze. Yeah,
it doesn't have to be green and yellow either. I mean, it can be if that's what you want, but like the thing that I'm so excited about, not only is one of my favorite models that I think is often overlooked getting is badass now. But it's your own security, and we'll get into the fluff and all this later, but they're their own shock team, so they can be very unique. They can be whatever color you want. Like, you get to create your own security team. I love that about this. This is one of my favorite things out there. So be creative. Show us your color. Show us your colors. I want to see your colors. Let me see what's happening on the west side or the north-south side, which isn't even a side. Rolling ones over here.
And hopefully... we'll get some Brawlers conversions.
Yes.
Because they don't even have models yet.
No.
So, yeah, anything from the new Sectorial, we'd love to see your merc colors. Let them fly. There's War Corps in there and Sato Togan and...
yeah, Sato Togan.
Hunza Coots and... you okay?
No, just all these funny names with like the new mark of the Primus, the whatever.
Valeria Gromaz.
Yeah. Valeria. I got a Valeria Gromaz from that bar.
But yeah, so that's the theme. And you have until April 2nd, the Monday after March ends. And you put all those pictures together in a single email. Name your photos with your name, please, and send them to Tom at MayaCast.com.
And Kip at MayaCast.com.
And good luck in high scoring. And hopefully we get a lot of entries and there's a lot of cool stuff. And I can't wait to see. Everybody's super excited about these Druze. And seems like, you know, everybody and their brother is putting together a new Druze army for the new Sectorial. And so can't wait to see your paint jobs and creativity. Good luck. High scoring. We'll let you know in 3 months. Meanwhile, congratulations, Tor and Joaquim. On their co-championship.
First co-champion in MayaCast history.
Yep. And congratulations, Florian and Dave, for winning a couple of random blister packs. Remember, the more entries we get, the more random stuff we give away. So let's fill her up for quarter one. You're stuck inside because it's freezing anyway. So get some stuff modeled up and painted.
Infinity Archives. Would you like to know more?
So 175 years into the future, mercenaries are more like corporations instead of just like bands of thugs and miscreants and violent dudes. The free companies are primarily focused on their military business. Mercs for mercs' sake. While the corporate contractors are generally like subsidiaries of a larger corporation that has various other interests and they're just one part of it. The war market is like a stock exchange for mercenary companies, as well as individual soldiers, where their performance, their reliability, their fame all contribute to the value of their shares, which are bought and sold like shares of any other commodity.
That's freaking crazy.
And they almost sort of rate the different mercenary companies and different mercenaries like...
I could just see the mercenary market. Oh, that's kind of a thing, right? Like everybody's sitting there like, the bell's wrong. Like, oh, look at that.
The war market. It's almost like a rating system as well for the different companies and the different mercenaries. Mm-hmm. Sort of like Yelp or Angie's List.
There you go.
all the human sphere governments have used and continue to use mercenaries when they need more manpower, certain sort of expertise that they may not have, or just to keep their own hands clean or not risk their own countrymen, their own soldiers, and whatnot. There are several famous mercenary companies out there that include the Dashat Company, which is almost like a private army for the corporate executive Kaid Dashat, and he uses it mostly for his own business interests. But he's one of the largest employers of mercenaries in the human sphere. There's the Foreign Company, which their full name is the Van Orten Military Contracts Foreign Company.
Okay.
That's
a lot.
But these are like celebrity mercs. They've got like shows on Maya where their exploits are sensationalized and glamorized.
Sort of like Dog the Bounty Hunter?
Kind of.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
That's cool.
There's the Free Company of the Star, which usually is shortened to Star Company or Starco.
Okay.
And they are mostly nomads, mostly ex-Corregidor soldiers. There's the Ikari Company, which are ex-Yujing soldiers, mostly Yanyans. The Varangian Guard. Yeah, they're a Caledonian mercenary unit.
Oh, no way!
On Ariadne, yeah.
How did I miss that? That's awesome.
The Anaconda Merc Tag Squadron.
Mm-hmm.
They were originally founded by the CJC, the Corregidor Jurisdictional Command.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, part of Corregidor, but now they're like their own mercenary company of kind of crazy tag pilots.
Yeah. Hanging out in France.
Kaplan Tactical Services, everybody knows because of the unit, and they're on Borak. And they are like the most professional and honorable mercenaries that are out there. They're a subsidiary of Bayhan Resources Incorporated.
Yeah. That reminds me of Aliens for some reason. What was that? That was the Yutani or whatever. And Wayland. There you go.
Wayland.
Yeah.
Seclock Contingencies. Seclock, security lock. Seclock Contingencies are the CSUs.
Oh, yeah.
They're bodyguards, corporate espionage. And there's the Yuan Yuans, of course, which are bloody, brutal pirates and reavers, corsairs flying throughout the galaxy, causing mayhem.
The privateers of the future.
And then, of course, what we were talking about tonight, the Druze Society. They're referred to as the Druze Mafia because it more accurately describes their business model. The Druze were a religious movement that blended Islam, Gnosticism, and other philosophies. And in the 21st century, their business ventures and their organized crime made them quite wealthy and powerful as a lot of current societies collapsed and reformed into the Infinity Factions. They control the East Africa Orbital Elevator. All the trade and transportation through there is under their control, and they have caravanseries around Borak's second wormhole where they're building new jump gates, and once those are completed and trade starts going through there, that's going to make lots of money for them.
Right.
Back in the day.
Which is today.
The Druze Society had a beef with one of the strongest Russian mobs that existed. At least one of the strongest Russian mobs that was not affiliated with Tunguska.
Mm-hmm.
It was the Drigalskis. And during this like turf war that they had, the Druze built what essentially became a private military force for themselves to combat the Russian mobsters, the Drigalskis. And these Druze shock teams killed every Drigalski foot soldier, partner, ally, boss, and all their families. And razed all their structures to the ground. I mean, there was nothing left of the Drigalski. No matter what the Drigalskis threw at them. nothing... Yeah,
lived. I was just saying, dead men tell no tales.
Nothing is left at all.
Oh man!
So rather than disband this military, they kept the shock teams around as mercenaries to hire out to folk, to governments, and each shock team is an independent company. So the Druze Society has several different shock teams. The competition between them keeps them like focused and strong, right? Because it's not just the Druze that get hired, but it's these certain companies.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's what I like about it. A lot of lore.
Yeah, the one that we get in the non-allied army is the Bayram Security. under the direction of Security Chief Arslan.
Got a little cool tip about that when you're done.
Okay. And they provide security for Bayram Caravansary and all the deep space Druze operations.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is just one, like, Druze section.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, all the power and money that they have gives them some amount of influence over the governments of Pan-Oceania and Hak-Islam.
Makes sense.
They are extremely well trained, and they're even better equipped. They're a paramilitary force that really is there to protect all the Druze trade routes. Because again, this Druze mafia is not just about the mercenaries. They have many other business interests.
Yeah, right.
Their motto is, we are mean, but we can be worse.
Right.
Their operations are known for excessive brutality and high body counts. Right? These are not nice people.
Mm-hmm.
For example, the Caledonian tragedy, where Druze shock teams in the employ of the Magna Opera Corporation, Magna Obra, leveled houses and slaughtered civilians on Ariadne. Engineers and miners that were refusing to work with the corporate prospectors, they came out and told them that their land was actually their land.
Mm-hmm.
And you should work, you know, you need to work for us. And so basically they were breaking up a strike. But whole families would go missing in the night and houses would get leveled and people would get workers, civilians.
Yeah, no bueno. Sounds like the early 1900s in the industrial age.
Joe
tried to strike.
Yeah. Joe Scarface Turner.
Mm-hmm. He's not welcome there very much.
Well, that's because during this time, he contracted with the Druze on Ariadne during the Ariadne commercial conflict.
Mm-hmm.
And so this was at the height of his addiction to grade 5 combat drugs. Where he was all spiraling out of control. And he was just violent and angry. This is before Cordelia, and she sort of grounded and centered him and whatnot. He was just a big old murderous rage ball.
Yeah.
And so he was all too happy to participate in the Druze war crimes under Magna Obra Corporation. So to this day, he's still a wanted man in Caledonia. And to this day, all these war crimes are currently like all held up in the Consilium courts.
Mm-hmm.
So hung up on red tape and whatever.
It's a mess. Yeah, right.
So the Druze are all being investigated, but they're like, hey, we were following our orders under contract to Magna Obra, so you got to investigate them, not us. We're just doing what we're told.
Right.
Magna Obra's like, they were just like a little too excited to do their job. So it's all a mess, but the takeaway is that you're just not not nice people, these Druze shock teams.
Yeah, so it's funny too. I've always liked the Druze as models, and ironically, I've been watching this show. I'm a little behind. The new 12 Monkeys series on, it's on Hulu. So I think it's a sci-fi show, based off the movie.
It was on sci-fi. Yeah.
Yeah. And at the end of the first season, I just started the second season, but at the end of the first season, if you've seen it, they're like trying to find this virus and they bring up, hey, the Druze are in Chechnya and they're trying to get this. And I was like, what? Because it was like 2 days after the sectorial ended, right? And I'm watching the show, it comes out. So I got super interested in it. I'm like, I know that it's based off of a real life religion, so I wanted to bring some of the reality lore in there. And I want to
get your willet on.
I'm gonna get my willet on, but I do want to do a disclaimer. This is based off of, you know, research and all that. Sorry, I'm fiddly. So if there's anybody out there that is actually part of this, because there are about 50,000 people, and that could be more, you never know, in the U.S. that are of the Druze faith. So if I get anything wrong, please don't get mad at me. This is just based off of internet research and just a few bullet points that I thought were interesting. Because it is still very secretive. It's very tight-knit. The couple of articles that I had read were based off of books that people wrote, and the Druze, they actually said, were their slogan was the Sons of Grace. So when you said that the security Bayram is one of the things, I think that my Druze faction will be called the Sons of Grace, now that you said that.
Then mine will be called the Sons of Will.
That works. But yeah, in history, they were extremely tight religious group. They were traced back to, about 1,000 years ago. It's anywhere between the year 1005 and 1009 is when they popped up in Egypt. So it's funny that they headed out to the eastern. I mean, you said they're in the East Africa, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in history, they came out of Cairo is where they kind of developed. Kind of funny. They believed that their God had incarnated on Earth around the year 1000, you know, nine, and his name was Al Hakim bi Amir Allah. And like infinity, once this happened, you know, there was a lot of persecution, so they moved to the mountainous regions in Lebanon, Syria, Israel. Later on, they actually emigrated into the U.S., which was funny. The first place they went was the Seattle area in the early 1900s, but in Australia, kind of all over the world. But Al-Hakim ended up disappearing about 11 years, you know, like 11 to 15 years later. They don't know if he was kidnapped, killed, just left. You know what I mean? Plane of existence. Nobody knows. It was a mystery. And one of his disciples actually had everybody go into the mountainous regions to hide, because everybody was like, you guys are crazy. Like, you're saying you're God, you're worshiping this guy. Like, think of Waco, you know, this guy's proclaiming that he is the Messiah in our time. If somebody came out and said they were God on earth, you'd probably think they were crazy, right?
Right.
So they go into the hills, they hide for about 6 years, and totally isolated before they came back down. And since then, they've been super secretive. You don't know a lot about what their real beliefs are. They do not allow new members. You cannot convert to the Druze faith. Since the year 1043, they have not allowed new members into their faith.
You can only be born into it?
Yep, you can only be born into it. In fact, so you can only marry into it as well. Like, if you want to get married, you have to be you have to marry somebody of the Druze faith. If you are in America, this is what I've read out of this book, they usually try to marry somebody internationally and bring them in. They don't want to marry anybody that's domestic. That could be wrong, but that's in the article that I read. Not Wikipedia, by the way. if anybody, they're a very tight-knit community as well, like nowadays in modern times. They always take care of each other, you know, help out with kids, help out with widows, and if you were to marry outside of your faith, you are excommunicated for life. Like, everybody will disown you. You're no longer part of it. So that's kind of crazy to me, but also very interesting. Back in the day when they were created, you know, this is in, you know, year 1009, right? 1043, they come out of hiding. Or they don't let people in. They were considered extremely radical at their time. When Al-Hakim was still around, they said he could handle things violently and very aggressively. But in nature, they're actually supposed to be very good and respective of other people. They were considered radical in their time because they thought that all men and women should be equal. And in the year like 1000, especially in those religious areas, that was unheard of, right? So they thought they fought for equality for men and women. They thought that all slavery should be abolished. And they also believed that if you were to be a nation, you should separate your church and your state. So it sounds like they're really ahead of their time back then, right? thought that was really neat. They're kind of like the United States of their day. Their religion was interesting. Well, you know what I mean, but, you know, separation of church and state, no slavery, all people are created equal. So religion is secret. They only allow a limited number. And again, disclaimer, I don't know everything I'm talking about. This is all from what I've been reading, but there's only a limited number of elite men and women, that they call the Uqual which Atlantid ones, they're the only ones that can study the full aspects of the religion. The rest of the Druze are considered Juhal, which is the unlightened, and they do not get access to their six holy books. So one of the they get a simplified version and the moral code that they're supposed to go by. I read in one thing that like once you're if you're in a traditional secret setting, there's one part of the service, and then when that's done, only the Yuqual get to stay and study the rest and meditate. I thought that was really interesting. One thing that can like be seen in Infinity where these shock teams are violent and don't really care about death is the core of the belief is a very strong belief in reincarnation. They think that your body is just like a robe for your soul. So if you die, you don't fear death, because if you die, you just shed your robe. And once your soul is released, you will be reborn into a new body shortly after you die. Unless you were an extremely horrible person and bad to your faith, then when you shed your robe, you actually will be reincarnated as a dog on Caledonia. But yeah, I just thought that was really cool. And the one thing I said is when you said, you know, the security chief Arslan, there's a reason why that is a character. Because in the current times, as of now, the current chief of the Druze in Lebanon, there's only two governing families. And the current chief is actually Emir, which is Prince Talan Arslan, because that family is like the main family, the Arslan family.
Wow.
They can trace their roots all the way back to the beginning. There's one other family that is heavily into government is basically one of pretty much royalty, and that's the Jumblats. But as of now in our times and in like the recent modern history, the Arslans are like the main royal family for the Druze faith.
Wow.
So I thought that was very interesting. So the security chief Arslan, even though like in the game that's his character name, that's actually kind of paying homage to this family who can trace their roots all the way back. And one last little tidbit, in my mind, I'm like, man, if they can only marry in their faith, like how, you know, are they going to run out? Even though they believe in equality for men and women, one of the things I read said that they do see having a son as an extra blessing. So say a family was to have five girls first, they would actually keep trying till they have a son. So this can lead to larger families. So larger family size, if you have five or six kids, they have five or six kids, they have five or six kids over 1,000 years. They said that there hasn't been a legitimate census taken since the 1930s. And so they estimate the faith worldwide around in between 700,000 to 2 million. So just imagine how many Druze would be around 175 years from now. Mm. That's a lot of armies and shock teams, especially if you're in, like, even if you're only keeping it real to your faith and not marrying outside of it. So I thought that was really interesting, man. Super, super. I want to read more about it. Honestly, it's they're very Gnostic. One thing I saw that said if they were ever in a Muslim setting that they would pray as Muslims. If they're in a Christian setting, they would actually pray as Christians. But their religion is kind of a blend of like Muslim and Judaism and Christianity. So extremely, extremely interesting to study about.
That's very, very cool. Yeah. I didn't know most of what you just said. That was
sweet.
Very enlightening. So Druze background, that's cool.
Mm-hmm.
They're a thing now. They've gotten their little limelight now. Mm-hmm. And so let's talk about them in the game.
The enemy of my enemy is my friend.
If you know the enemy and know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles.
Any heavy resistance, sir?
Yes. But why are they using such primitive weapons?
Now entering the war room.
So the Druze Bayram Security Sectorial offers a limited selection of models, right? And you may look at it and see that it doesn't, you don't even have to scroll, it all fits on one computer screen. And like Caledonia or the French or whatever else, you may think, oh, well, that's not a lot of options. But just like all the other sectorials, there's actually a broad and wide variety of ways you can go building armies out of this faction. And, you know, there's a multitude of different fire teams and whatnot that you can build in all sorts of different ways. There's core, there's Harry's, there's multiple duos, and then there are models that can join other fire teams, like Arslan counts as a Druze for fire team creation, and Valeria Gromaz can join any
That's huge.
Fire team
huge
in the sectorial. And so there are many different ways that you can create them. And because fire teams aren't created until deployment, right, you may build your list and think, okay, I'm going to run this as a fire team. And you may, you know, depending on the opponent or the mission or the table, you may say, you know, my original idea of this fire team, I'm actually going to switch you over to this fire team. And, you know, as long as you have the tools there. But it's super exciting because the Druze get a whole new profile, a whole new workup of options, and they count as veteran troops, which means for hunting party, they're all going to get a glue gun.
Oh my gosh. I didn't think about that.
And
that's amazing.
And Arslan, even though he's a character, he also counts as a veteran troop. And and so there's a whole lot of options and a whole lot of nifty things and a whole lot of different ways you can approach it. You can, I think we mentioned a couple weeks ago when we just brushed on it with the other guys here that the hacking presence can be enormous. If you'd like to run it that way. There are tags that you can take. There are whole lots of different and fun things. So,
you know what I wanted to say to you, like, and this goes like you were saying, reading the rules over and over again and catching the little things. The fact that you don't have a fire team until deployment, and with the amount of duo that's available in here, that can completely change how you're going to play. It's insane. And I never thought about that. Like in the past, we've done like, oh, well, you can have multiple fire team options if you have Haris or two core options if you're taking like a U.S. Ariadna list. In part, like in my mind, you're like, oh yeah, you just choose which one. But it's like if you deploy them in a certain fashion, I never thought about the fact of it's like, well, you're creating it at the deployment phase. So with something like this, it can change to where you have a core and a Haris to maybe like five duos. You know what I mean? Like if that's going to help you out a little bit better, which is insane.
So you've got the authorized bounty hunter, which a few sectorials have had before, right? And that sniper, man, that is a steal at half an SWC. Because one of the things I find when playing around with army and building lists and stuff is that this sectorial, you become very starved for SWC.
Yeah, you do.
Very quickly.
Yes, you do.
And so having a sniper rifle that's only half an SWC at ballistic skill 12, 21 points,
21.
But the half SWC becomes a steal. At 15 to 22 points, they're one of the cheaper offensive options that's not just like a repeater bot, but something that has a gun. And then you've got the booty chart where you never know what you're going to get. You could end up with a sniper that has ODD or a sniper that's armor 5 because they get the plus 4 armor.
Yeah, that's insane. And one of the things I liked about them is, again, and this is a theme, and I get super blinders when I find something cool, and I need to quit doing that when a new thing comes out. But my favorite thing about them, besides the half SWC 21, is their Spitfire is a cheap option that can duo. Or what I've been trying to do, because they're cheaper, is like two boarding shotguns or two combi rifles, so that you can duo up the board. and have a nice little suppression fire. It'll break their fire team, but that's a lot. You're not using a lot of orders to get two people up the field and protect your flank. Like I said, there's a lot of duo here, and that's been like the one thing that stood out to me. Kind of overlooked the sniper. I'm glad that you said that, because in my mind I'm like, oh man, those two combis are awesome to like just run together, and if you get something even cooler in the booty level, that makes them even harder to deal with.
Right, and super cheap.
Yep.
Bashi Bazooks are even cheaper at 12 to 17, and they have parachutists, so they can walk. You know, you've got to choose your board edge during deployment, and they've got to come in there. But
that's the one thing.
They're only 12 to 17 points. They have Holo Projector 2.
That's the good thing. And that's, I played with a lot of parachutists with the in US Ariadna, and I need to quit overlooking how awesome those are, because I haven't really. In my mind, I'm like, oh, but you got to choose before. But that 12-point holo projector level 2 model.
Right, with some machine gun and a chain colt.
Yeah, that's not bad.
Yeah. So you've got, you know, that the template and the face-to-face weapon.
Mm-hmm.
And 12 points, you know. Probably, and then 12 points is easy for, like, as the person's trying to figure out, like, you know, you've got your... your order pool of 10 and your order pool of 4 out on the table, and they're like, okay, and they're running, okay, so that should be everything. But, you know, 12 points is easy to, like,
to overlook. Fake in
there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Unless you're playing a savant that, you know, has everything memorized. Sure, right. But they're irregular, but you're going to want to spend orders on them anyway until they're dead, so that's usually not an issue. But
it'd be a good last-ditch effort, too, like, if you wanted to take the specialist option.
Yeah, 17.
And run them in because they're hollow too. So you're just like, well, I'm going to do a suicide run, but it's kind of a little bit better odds because they're like, which cups the ball under? Like, as they're trying to shoot you and not let you push the button at the end of the game.
New models are great.
Yeah.
The Brawlers, brand new troop type. These guys are only availability 4. They range from 16 to 28 points. They have a toolbox of different options. There's an MSV2 sniper.
Yeah.
There's a heavy rocket launcher. You have an assault hacker, an engineer, a doctor, a cheap lieutenant at 0 SWC and 16 points.
Mm-hmm.
Where, you know, you see the Druze that has the combi rifle and chain colt.
Yeah.
And you're like, well, that's a lieutenant.
Yeah.
Or you see Arslan and you're like, well, that's a lieutenant. Well, it could be that brawler.
Mm-hmm.
Over there with what do they have?
Rifle light shotgun.
Yeah. They have a Harry's guy, and like you were saying, the different fire teams.
Yeah,
they can duo.
Duo. That's
they have a Harry's guy, so you can form a Harry's with them. And they have a special core option where it can be 2 Druze with up to 3 brawlers,
which is kind of nice if you want to take the cheap route.
Right, and remember, Valeria can join any fire times, so she could duo with a brawler.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say you take 2 Druze and 3, 2 Druze and 3 brawlers. Mm-hmm. That leaves you with 1 brawler left, availability-wise. Well, he can still duo with Valeria because she can join any fire team.
Yeah, and you have options on that too, because I've thought about this because I like be able to take special characters. So I'm like, ooh, duo with Valeria. Like, you could do engineer with Valeria, so you have D charges and your hacker, or run a double hacker. You have her as a hacker and then the brawler assault hacking device. So that makes it even scarier for somebody that wants to come around and get into either of their hacking area, because they're gonna have to deal with 2 people. So that's kind of nice. And even if you just want to keep her safe, like I said, you can run the doctor or engineer. They both have rifle light shotguns. Doctor can bring her back up if she does lose a face-to-face battle against another hacker, and it can't be hacked. So that's kind of nice, being able to run around together like that. That's the synergy I like about this. I'm super stoked about that. The duo shouldn't be overlooked.
Druze can get expensive.
Yeah, they can.
So these guys help to keep your cost down, your cost per order down.
Yep.
And... the other option is you can, in a Druze core fire team, you can have up to 1 brawler as well. So you can really do the Harrys of Brawlers mm-hmm. and then have a Druze fire team that also includes that fourth Brawler. Keeping things cheap, adding those extra options like mm-hmm. heavy rocket launcher that the Druze don't have, or
yep,
doctor.
The MSV2 sniper.
Because Druze have a paramedic, but they don't have a doctor.
Nope.
So you can have the Brawler doctor in there instead.
Mm-hmm.
And they're 4-4, so they don't suffer the same slowness of the Druze.
Yeah.
But like with all the fire teams and all the duos and Harrys mm-hmm. and... sort of mitigates that inefficiency of 4-2 because you're moving multiple models mm-hmm. with every order.
Yeah, that's kind of the thing I like about the, you know, I'm a big fan of defensive fire teams, right? But mm-hmm. they're getting a little bit easier to deal with. But with this, with all the duos and then you can Harrys, this is kind of like the defensive fire team core, and then you have all your other guys out running amok around the table, right? And like you said, very cheap. You can have a missile launcher and an MSV2 sniper because you have the Clipper and then the Brawler and then your three Druze in that core fire team.
And then using your command tokens to adjust your fire teams on the fly.
Yeah.
Where, you know, yes, that Brawler was part of the five-man Druze team.
Mm-hmm.
That maybe that was my aero presence or something, right?
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm going to reform a link team. Take that Brawler out of there, add him to these other two Brawlers. Now this Harry's team is going to move up to go get yeah. some objectives. But yeah, you can switch those fire teams on the fly.
Yeah, it's awesome. Really synergetic. And again, I am a super fan of all of the duo. Literally, because this is extremely order efficient.
So you've got Valeria Grimaz.
Mm-hmm.
And she's a regular hacking device with the addition of the Expel program.
Nice.
Kicking pilots out of tags. She's armed with a combi rifle and pitcher, but she's only ballistic skill 11.
Yeah.
She's whip 14. It's yeah. only her and the Hunzikutes that get up to whip 14 yeah. in the entire faction. It's your highest whip. BTS 0, though, on a hacker, and one wound.
Yeah, the BTS
not
0.
Not durable.
But she's a regular hacking device at... Well, most of them are half at SWC.
Yeah, half at SWC, so, 21 points. She's not super expensive.
No.
But then, again, she can join any fire team. And so, again, pumping up the duos, you can put her in a duo with Scarface. And now Cordelia's on her own.
I was just doing that in my head. I was like,
that allows Cordelia... to have NASMAT remotes so she can engineer things from afar and stay safe.
Okay.
Because if you're in a fire team, you can't have G servants.
Mm-hmm.
So you can duo with Scarface, and you want to duo Scarface to mitigate his frenzy. Because as soon as he causes first blood, now he's going to be impetuous and can't benefit from cover and all that stuff. So duo Scarface with Valeria, because she can join any... fire team, and Scarface has duo, and Cordelia has duo, so she can join either one, but join her with Scarface to keep him from being impetuous. They can move up together, and meanwhile, Cordelia then gets to use servant bots, which is nice. But yeah, other than her, Hunzikuts are the only other whip 14 in the sectorial, and Hunzikut, their specialist is a 18-point forward observer, which is a regular, of course, but it's a camo infiltrator, which is sorely lacking in the faction.
Yeah, I think that's the only one that's camoed.
Infiltration.
There's one other one, but...
Saito,
yeah.
So, yeah, she's
but that's
useful.
That's expensive.
You also have that vast range of remotes, right?
Mm-hmm.
From the missile launcher bot to the forward observer bot to your total reaction bot. And she has a normal hacking device, so she can use the supportware programs on those bots and help support those things. If she's duoed with... you got to be careful if she's duoed with Scarface, though, right? Because...
Then you activate... He gets shot.
If she goes to put support where and he's out where people can see him, then you get him shot. So don't do that. Warcores, everybody knows. They're cheap. Mm-hmm. Flash Pulse, 3-point irregular order that, again, with a command token, can become a regular order when you need it in a pinch. But really, annoying little Flash Pulse at whip 13.
I'm blinding you.
And I'm 3 points, so I don't care if I die.
Mm-hmm.
Da-da.
Died to you.
So, yeah. Armand. Armand is an interesting inclusion here.
Hey, he's a merc.
And, so, I mean, he's a fantastic piece, right? He's got ODD. He's got that forward deployment, so he can get that just out of reach sniper nest, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's 14 inches from the table edge that you'd really like to be in cover on and can't with a normal 12-inch regular deployment. He's basically has two wounds with his symbiont armor.
Yep.
And it's a multi-sniper rifle with BS-13 on a guy that has ODD.
Yeah, it's nice.
So he's a great model. You can take the thing is, he's expensive.
Very, yeah. 42 or 45.
45. The extra 3 points gets him MSV1. Not even 2.
Yeah. And I honestly don't even like doing that a lot of times, because if they have any hackers, they just white noise you. Now you're screwed, because you have to shoot back at -6. It kind of... It's basically like, oh, you have ODD? Well, now you can't see me as I shoot you. And you don't even get to see through smoke.
Right. Just slightly mitigate some other penalties. 1.5 SWC, 45 points, 42 points. He does have mines. Comes with a nanopulsor, 2 breaker pistols. If things get too close for comfort. But like I said before, the Druze starve for those SWC.
Yeah.
And 1.5 on him and a sixth of your army points.
Yep.
It's, remember those authorized bounty hunters? Those snipers at 0.5 and 21? Mm-hmm. So for the same price as non-MSV Armand, you can get 2 of those authorized bounty hunter snipers, which they are availability to, and that's only 1 SWC and 42 points.
Yeah, and they could possibly get ODD.
And they could possibly get ODD, yeah. So you can cover 2 vectors, 2 fire lanes, 2 orders of approach. They provide 2 orders, not 1.
Yep.
They don't have mines, but you know that you've got double the ARO effectiveness for the same price and an extra order.
Yep.
Which is, you know, those orders are precious. 1 less ballistic skill, but
I would kind of take that, though.
He's cool. He's an excellent piece. He's just
I'm a fan.
So expensive.
Remember when he first came out, and I was like, "Whoa, I'm gonna put him in every list that I can while I can, just because I can." I'm glad I did that then, so I don't do it now. I've thrown him in a couple lists here, but it's the exact reasons that you just said is why I leave him out. I think that the only time that I'm really looking at him is limited insertion, because it can be a little rough, because even though Druze are expensive with all the other options that you want, they're for like specialists or anything, they're inexpensive. So I've actually found it difficult.
Unless you're taking the tag.
Unless you're taking tags to go limited insertion. But that is, I'm only theory building and not building to a set of missions that you'd be playing. So I'm pretty sure that would change things up a little bit. But that's where I see him kind of shining, is when you're trying to build a limited insertion list. So you're bringing your elite of elite expensive models.
And he's a good ARO piece, but he rarely lives past that first turn. With the burst 2 on active turn, it's not. You want more burst on active turn. Sniper rifles, just another. But as an ARO piece that can sit and watch a fire lane or an objective or two, he could be hard to dislodge, or somebody could have MSV2 and wipe out his whole advantage.
Yeah.
And MSV2 hitting you with a burst 4 HMG against your burst 1 ARO sniper. You know, when you used to play him, sometimes he would kill a couple things, but usually it was he burned 3 or 4 orders.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Kronted HMG kind of ruins his day. Really bad, actually.
So he's just so expensive. But you're right. In limited insertion, he becomes a more attractive option. So the meat and potatoes, I guess, are the total availability Druze. I mean, the sectorial is named after him, right?
Yep.
So the Druze shock teams. They are only 4-2 move.
Yeah.
Which is the same, you know, whether you're talking about Wildcats or Bolts or Rodox or any of those medium infantry fire teams. What do they have that makes them special?
Well, a whole lot now. Back in the day, I remember it was like, oh, X-Fizers, yay.
But, which, I mean, don't sneeze at it, but...
No, they're amazing, actually. I've seen them save people. But in the faction that they were in, it's like, oh, for the same points, I can get this, 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 and this, which is which is hard to argue, right? But now that they get their own fire team, I mean, the first thing that shot out to me is, A, you have way more options.
Yeah, there's 11 different loadouts.
Yeah, I think originally it was like 5.
It's 11 different loadouts.
Yeah, and so you look at it, you're like, oh my gosh, look at all this. And then the second thing that stood out, even above the duos and the cores, was the fatality.
Right, yeah, so their stat line, ballistic skill 12 and whip 13, they have 3 armor, which if you've ever faced U.S. Ariadna, you're like, why won't you die?
Yeah.
Only the 1 wound. Their total availability, fatality level 1, and that's a +1 modifier to damage on ballistic skill weapons. Whenever you declared a ballistic skill attack with a ballistic skill weapon, +1 to the damage. So now you've got damage 14 combi rifles at burst 4. So even your cheapest guy is basically a short-range Spitfire now.
Yep.
Burst 4, of course, because they're in a fire team, we're assuming, of 3 or more. And then veteran level 1, which they can't be isolated.
Nope, that's amazing.
Which puts them in a great position for hunting party. They and just in general.
They laugh at mutts.
Yeah. And, you know, ignore retreat and all that stuff, right? But yeah, so that core stat line is... fantastic. Fatality, especially.
And I really like that they have BTS-3. Because it's like, oh, now you hit me with plasma, and I'm... Well, now I have 3, not 0. Yeah. Or viral. Not with a template in cover. You're like, sweet! 2 BTS rolls at 6. That's awesome! But I really like the HMG. It's a burst 5, damage 16. Nice.
At ballistic skill 15.
Yep, at a 5 man. Oh, so good. And they're all viral pistols. So that's really nice if somebody is like, oh, I'm going to get close. Nope.
And, well, that's great because then the bolts with their viral immunity just laugh.
That's true.
Anyway, and that would be a great opponent, like, lore-wise. Fire team options. They're a core fire team. So you can make 5 Druze. You know, up to 3 to 5 Druze. They have a special core where you can include up to 1 brawler and or up to 1 clipper drone bot.
That's my favorite, though. And or.
Right. So you can take 3 Druze, a brawler, and a clipper.
Yeah.
4 Druze and a clipper. 4 Druze and a brawler. For the maximum of 5. Or, hey, 2 Druze and 1 brawler. And it's still a core fire team. But you didn't spend all your points. You just don't get up to that +3, yeah, +6 skill. So then there's the guy with Harry's. So you can form a Harry's team out of Druze. And again, they're total availability. So you can spam the field with Druze as long as your points last.
I like that you said that because most of the time, like, my mind's been going, oh, the Druze core with the clipper and the blah, blah, blah. But if you don't really want that, then, yeah, run the core of 2 Druze and 3 brawlers. And then the Harry's Druze. Because they have fatality, and that's a really nice unit running up the field.
And then, yeah, you just mentioned their special core, the 2 Druze and up to 3 brawlers, which we mentioned in the brawler. We're talking about them. Now, at 23 to 32 points each, this is not a, you know, super cheap team to field. But they have options out the wazoo.
Yeah.
Like I said, there are 11 different profiles. 11 different loadouts. So the gun options, right? There's combi rifle and chain colt. is the default loadout. There's an HMG guy that you alluded to.
Yep.
There's a multi-sniper, and that guy has mimetism.
Yeah, that's nice.
out of nowhere. Which I kind of love and kind of hate. I love it because, like, oh, he's a sniper that gets this built-in negative three to hit him, but I also hate it just from a elegance and simplicity standpoint where I'm like, I got to remember this one guy has mimetism, but not all of them,
yeah.
And just from, yeah, elegance and simplicity, I really like the ones where all of the data Razi have mimetism, right? Not just the one with the chain rifle.
Yeah, and
right,
this whole loadout's like filled with those.
Oh, right,
like, that option doesn't have an X visor, but that one does
have an X visor. Yeah, HMG no X visor.
No,
but all the things around it have X. Yeah,
yeah.
So yeah, multi sniper with mimetism. There's a shock marksman rifle.
Oh, that's one of my favorites.
That has an X visor.
That's one of my favorites.
And he's zero SWC, which is probably why he's one of your favorites.
Yep.
And fatality.
Yeah. And 14. The X shock.
So
better range.
But then my favorite is the combi and light grenade launcher. And the light grenade launcher is packing Nimbus and EM ammo. And bonus, he has an X-Visor.
Yeah.
So when you're spec firing far away, you're going to be at zero.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then so you just take the negative six. Half an SWC, 27 points for that guy. Then you have the skill options, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where you've got a lieutenant option, who's your standard rifle and chain Colt, obvious sort of lieutenant. You have a paramedic, and so specialist.
That's an X-Visor.
Yeah, specialist. Then there are two hacker options. Both of the hacker options, in addition to their combi rifle, right?
Mm-hmm.
They also include pitchers.
Yep.
And D charges.
Super cool.
There's the assault hacker. He's half an SWC like most are and 28 points. But then the killer hacker, zero SWC, 25 points.
Hey, that's my favorite one.
Specialist can go blow the brains out of any enemy hackers and has D charges, so it can get the sabotage classified as well, or blow up the AC2.
Yeah.
Killer hacker. Woo! For added fun, you can take that combi rifle chain Colt standard loadout, add a Panzerfaust to it, not pay any SWC, and it's only 25 points, 2 points more than the regular.
A 2-point Panzer's good.
And then there's you can get a DEP, but it only comes on the guy who has Harris.
Yeah.
And Harry's is one full SWC between the Harry's ability and the DEP. And
kind of like the Panzerfaust better.
And that is why I sort of prefer the Brawler Harry's team and a Druze core.
Yeah.
Because the Brawler Harry's guy, I think, is only 0.5 SWC.
I'm pretty
and
sure.
It lets you take, the...
Yep, 0.5.
Yep.
So good.
Oh, geez. That's me slamming a notebook into the microphone. Don't worry, I'll edit it out later. But yeah, it lets you take things like a heavy rocket launcher in a sniper. I think he's a multi-sniper, isn't he?
Regular sniper.
The Brawler?
I believe so, yeah. Let me look.
You go check that out. But it lets you take that as like a deep... You like your defensive fire teams. Well, these are ARO pieces. They're getting burst two with really good weapons.
I'm stupid and wrong. Multi-sniper.
Multi? Yep.
MSV2.
That's right, MSV2 multi-sniper and a heavy rocket launcher.
28 points.
Extra burst. So, and then your Harry's dude is only half an SWC because, once again, you can use those SWC up really quick. But the Druze, so many options. You know, you may see six Druze fire teams and none of them are identical. Everybody kind of looks for that Death Star where everybody takes the same thing over, right? I'm going to take the Harrimaki with two missile launchers, right? Five-man, right?
Yeah.
Or whatever. But there are so many different ways you can kit it out depending on what you want to do. I want to lob EM grenades at people all day long. And then once you're all isolated and dumb, now I'm going to run out with my HMG guy leading the way, and then to get my specialists into position. Or I might take a missile launcher bot and have him trail behind everybody so he's, you know, mm-hmm. good range for as long as possible. Or I'm going to mix in the brawlers so I get the 5-man bonus on that heavy rocket launcher that the brawler brings along to the Druze that the Druze don't have themselves.
And, yeah. You know what's which one is fun when you're talking about like the Panzerfaust is, yeah, I'm going to take the Clipper because I get the template that's, you know, explosive and AP. But also like three other Druze with Panzerfausts, with a Camille by, with baggage. So you can shoot a bunch of Panzerfausts and reload them. Could you imagine that ARO? You're like, well, I'm going to go two Panzers here, two missiles here, two Panzers here, and two Panzers here on attack.
And the enemy avatar goes, oi.
Yeah, that's just funny. I mean, yeah, after that shot, they're out until their next active turn, but in a pinch, I mean, against the really high armor.
I got ODD, but this sucks.
Yeah. Because they have X visors too. So,
but I've been liking the idea of that of a Druze Corps with a brawler doc, because the Druze only have a paramedic.
Yeah,
and I would much rather have a doctor than a paramedic if I ever want to heal up my dudes and get my orders back. And even though he's, you know, a whip, one whip less, I think. All right, then another 13. Look up brawlers there for me.
Yeah, Druze 13. I think brawlers are 13 as well. Off the top of my head. Oh, no, they're only 12.
That's it. Yeah, so they're 12. They're like Pano docs. But I'd rather have a Pano doc. Yeah, that's why they wear berets. Berets make you dumb.
I was like, yeah, that's
sorry, better. France.
Yeah, a whip 12 is better than your paramedic trying to heal on an 8.
Yeah. No, thank you.
That's better.
So, and it's an extra specialist, and he's cheaper.
Yeah.
And then the Harrys of the Brawlers, heavy rocket launcher and sniper... Mm-hmm. And then you can, you know, that third member of the Harrys can be that regular zero SWC 16-point brawler, and he's your lieutenant, but he's like prone somewhere safe. So that, clearly that Druze is the lieutenant. No, it was a guy hiding in the back with the ARO team the whole time. But the idea of bringing that heavy rocket launcher into a core team of 5,
yeah,
you get the extra burst and you get the extra 3 ballistic skill.
Mm-hmm. 3 bursts.
Is tasty, simpler, yeah. Yes.
Unfortunately, yes. It doesn't get the fatality, so it's just normal.
Well, right.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's just a crazy mixed fire team. Like Valeria could come along.
Mm-hmm.
You throw Arslan in there.
I kind of liked Valeria. Like, the most of the time that I was using Valeria, it was either a duo or in the Harry's team.
And by using, you mean building lists?
Building lists, yeah. In theory. My stuff's still on the way.
Because you're going to break out the great proxy army of Druze on Monday, right?
Unless, because I got a notification and it says Wednesday that they're filling my order. So if it comes in on, like, Saturday, I'll build it all.
Do it Dexter style?
Yeah.
Glue them together as you're playing?
I'll stay up really late Sunday and build it all together.
All right, so Druze, there's going to be a million permutations, a million ways to use them. They're also total availability, so you could have the core team or even the core of 2+3 brawlers or whatever you're going to do. But then you have, like you said, a couple guys with combi rifles, or maybe one's a specialist. Paramedic. Mm. And right, and just... have the duos, and yeah, they're 4-2, but you're also moving 2 models at once. So you lose 25% efficiency on the move, going from 4-4 to 4-2, but you gain, you know, you're moving 2 models for once, so you get, it's 100% increase.
Yeah, that's way better. That's why I kind of like the fact that there's all the duos there, because it is more efficient.
So speaking of Arslan...
Yeah, I just popped him up.
And heyo. He's the Druze boss.
Yeah.
And so he's like a super Druze, but not really. But he's priced like one.
Yeah.
He's a 4-2 move, of course, plus 6 kill 13.
Yay.
Whip 13, armor 3. So there's, I mean, lieutenant options. either him or the Druze at whip 13, or then you're down to the brawler at whip 12.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to win that, if you don't care if you go first or second or what side of the table you get, or what, if you don't care about winning those roles, then, you know, go ahead and take the brawler. But,
yeah, 13's super low.
It's only 5% difference, but, yeah, but it feels it seems so worse. Like so much more than 12. It's funny because we're saying opposite things and agreeing with each other. He's armor 3.
So bad.
Like the Druze are, and he has one wound like the Druze are, but he also has no wound incapacitation.
It's really good. Let's get it with Shaq.
He has an MSV1. He has the duo ability,
mm-hmm.
so he can duo with Valyria or another Druze. He has Fatality level 1, just like the rest of the Druze. So his multi-rifle that he's armed with becomes damage 14.
Yep.
And he has Hyperdynamics level 1, which makes his Physique 11 actually pretty good at dodging on mm-hmm. 14s. And Veteran level 1. But yeah, so multi-rifle light shotgun. Good at all ranges up to mm-hmm. 16. And does he have the... He doesn't have the X-Visor, does he?
No. I kind of wish...
Dumb.
I kind of wish he did. He's the chief, and the majority of your other guys all have X-Visors.
Well, character, so no helmet.
Oh, that's right.
But he could get Chiba eye implants. Yeah. Anyway. Yeah, Viral Pistol. He's 36 points. Is the addition of one ballistic skill and the addition of a multi-rifle to your Druze fire team
and worth, no wounded cap
worth the extra 11 points? Yeah, maybe with the no wounded cap, but there's a lot of shock out there nowadays. So
if you're at rifle range and he gets his two shots at a ballistic skill 16 and a 5-man at double action, ooh, that's kind of nice.
I'm talking about aero.
Yeah, I mean... Because if he is your lieutenant option, you have him there covering, like, if somebody drops in on you, he's more survivable. I do like multi-rifles a lot more than I used to.
So, dicking about with list building,
mm-hmm.
and I'm always like, I really need, like, 8 points.
Mm-hmm.
And then I look at Arslan, I'm like, you can become a regular Druze lieutenant, and I can save 11 points. And now I've got those 8 extra points I needed, plus I can add a war core.
Or a war core.
Or a NASMAT.
Yeah. I always forget about the war cores.
Mm-hmm.
I overlook the war core every time. Oh, NASMAT, who can't.
Which
do
is
anything.
Ironic because usually it's the war core overlooking you on the battlefield.
It's because you and Lewis have both ruined my day with NASMATs. Or the equivalent. No, they were both NASMAT. No, NASMAT and a slave drone.
Slave drone. Nurse worm.
Nurse worm. Both of you guys have cost me a game with those by engaging an electric pulsing. Or you just engaged and cost me that 4 inches of movement, which would have got me off the table. I drop in with a tiger soldier. He goes, engage. And then I lost every face-to-face roll against electric pulse. It was ridiculous.
You just got to beat a 7. You know who was impressed with Nurse Worm? Anecdote. Owen.
Really?
Was it Dave? Darn it. They're such good friends. And now I don't confuse them, but I've confused the game.
The games.
So either Owen or Dave.
Okay.
Maybe it was Dave. I think it was Dave. Pretty sure it was Stilgar. He had finally, after much trial and tribulation, taken down the Avatar. And when we first started setting up, he's like, the one thing I didn't want to face with this army was an Avatar.
Mm-hmm.
And, well, I got one for you.
And I think it was Stilgar.
Yeah. So he finally, after much work, takes down the Avatar. The Avatar is unconscious.
Mm-hmm.
And activate Dr. Worm. And bloop, 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 bloop. Healed it back up to 1. Spend another order on Dr. Worm. Bloop, 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 bloop. Healed it back up to 2. Spend another order on Dr. Worm. Bloop, 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 bloop. Healed it back up to full 3. Not healed, but engineered.
Yeah, engineered.
Because the only way to heal back up to full is Akbar Doctor.
Yeah.
But yeah, so healed all 3 structure points. But yeah, and then boom, full strength Avatar right on the center objective. It was It was good times. Dave was he was super impressed and had a great time that game. That is sarcasm, and I apologize because he's a super nice guy.
Yeah.
But yeah, he feels a little expensive, Arslan.
Yeah.
Feels a little expensive. And I was thinking all like crazy conversions, like, oh, he's armor three, he's a big tough guy, he's got no wounding cap, I'm going to use that authorized bounty hunter heavy infantry model, the limited edition one,
mm-hmm.
with like the coat over his armor.
Yeah.
And then like somehow get Stephen Rao's luxurious locks,
mm-hmm.
put that head on there because Arslan, Aslan.
Yes.
Lion.
Yep.
But then I realized I've got the limited edition beyond the pre-order version of Beyond Red Veil, Beyond mm-hmm. Ice Storm. Beyond Ice Storm. I gave you Beyond Red Veil.
Yeah.
So I got and that comes with that bounty hunter guy or whatever he is, who looks kind of like a Druze dude that has the same like face as Arslan in the comic. So I'm just going to use that guy.
He's fine. He's got a pistol.
And then I'll never take him. Because I always need those few extra points, and I downgrade the lieutenant to somebody else. You don't have to take him as a lieutenant either.
No.
You could definitely use him to play hide the lieutenant.
I think I like that option better.
So, anything else on Arsface?
No.
Arsface? Anaconda tag. Upgrade.
I was gonna say that got upgraded because that used to be one of the even. This is hard for me. So even if I like the only way I'd play it is like Merovingian, and even in Merovingian, I'm like, oh, there's so many better options. Because why am I gonna take a Spitfire that's only Structure 2 and Armor 6? Playing Blackjacks, I know how easily that model can go down with crits or just really bad dice roll on your part. So it was always kind of like, but now.
Well, yeah. So he is only Structure 2. He is only Armor 6.
Mm-hmm.
He's fairly inexpensive, though, at 62 points.
I like how we're saying he and the pilot's a woman.
Sure. Well, the Anaconda itself looks masculine to me.
Yes, it does.
Spitfire plus Light Flamethrower, 2 and 62. HMG and Chain Colt... 2 and 64.
Mm-hmm.
I like that the Chain Colt is since this option is the Druze option,
mm-hmm.
the Druze upgrade, if you will.
Yeah.
I like how it's thematic that they gave it a Chain Colt. But
that's
like, why would they retrofit the flamethrower to anyway?
Yeah.
Seems like you would want the
much
tactical flexibility. Yeah.
Which rather have the flamethrower.
And both of them have a Panzerfaust.
They do.
So he's a cool little weapons platform. He's armor mm-hmm. 9 in cover. So
yeah, that means good.
And he's cheap enough that you can take him and Scarface and Cordelia in the same army list.
Yeah.
And run a double tag list, especially in limited insertion. Or not even in limited insertion because of the new rules where you make your 10-order list
mm-hmm.
and you don't have to sacrifice those two orders to an enemy command token. Honestly, I wish it was 52 points, but it's fine. It's, you know.
I agree. It's Structure 2. It's so hard.
The Structure 2, yeah.
I'd much
and
rather
4-4 move.
Yeah, I'd much rather take Scarface, like, almost every time. Because I think together they're
Anaconda definitely outranges Scarface.
Yeah, with range, but...
That's what outranges means, yeah. So,
shit.
He outranges him with range. But yeah, I agree with your sentiment. If you have to take one, I would rather have Scarface and Cordelia because you get two orders for only a few more points.
10 more points.
Yeah. And you get two orders and Scarface got an upgrade for the Druze as well.
What am I missing on that?
Well, oh, the heavy rocket. Yeah, he's got a heavy rocket
heavy
launcher
rocket
now.
Launcher, yeah. I was like, so there's your range. I was like, why was he saying range? But that is it. That's your long range weapon. It doesn't have a lot of burst.
But think about it. So he's got the new heavy rocket launcher. Also, in this season of ITS, all tags get fatality level 1.
Yeah.
Well, Scarface is the Druze tag,
yeah.
And all the Druze now have fatality, so he fits right in.
Yep.
He's so iconic to the faction.
He's got the same helmet on his tag that they wear, just slightly larger.
I just like it. I mean, he has two Mark 12s, so you have a burst 4, so it's like the HMG. Yes, it doesn't have the range of an HMG, but it's damage 16. At long range, you have the heavy rocket launcher, which I like.
The Mark 12s on him. All right, so you get two.
Yeah.
So you burst 4.
Yeah.
And you are damage 16 because of tags.
Yeah.
Getting fatality. And, I mean, that's good.
Yeah. And it's 10 more points than the HMG, but it's only 1.5 SWC in an SWC star army. So
it's a mega Spitfire. It's a damage 16 Spitfire because it's good out to 24, but then your heavy rocket launcher is good out to 32.
Yeah, which is supplement your, you don't get the extra two dice that the HMG does, but at least you have that range band covered. And I like it better. I like it the way it looks better. I like that you have an engineer that's rolling with you. You have three structure, and you're still manned. So after those three structure go down, Scarface is still alive. So it's not like it's dead. You can have Cordelia pop it back up and he jumps back in and continues going. You know what I mean? Like, I like it a lot more, and it's a lot more thematic.
And his biggest weakness, so one of his weaknesses are the low armor, right? He's an armor 5
instead of
tag,
6.
With 3, and he's big. He's not one of the small tags. He's a big tag. And armor 5, 3, he does have the 3 structure, which you didn't like about the Anaconda. But one of the biggest weaknesses was that frenzy. And as soon as you cause a wound, you become impetuous. Now you're running blindly towards the enemy. And taking arrows that you don't want, maybe.
Here comes that lore.
Or maybe it's a maybe you see it as a benefit. Now I get a free extra order, so I like the frenzy.
But you don't ever get cover.
But you don't ever get cover, and he's only armor 5 to begin with. Armor 5 is Asriel.
Yeah, nah.
Armor 8?
That's not bad. Yeah, it's not bad.
So
bring that lore on back. Bring that lore on back.
Loron?
The lore on back. Like the lore of Scarface and Cordelia. Mm-hmm. Like, bring that lore.
So, now that he has duo,
and
Cordelia has duo, you can, of course, duo them. As it says, special fire team, Scarface and Cordelia. So you can duo them. But Valeria says can join any fire team. So since Scarface has duo, she can join his fire team.
So is it special fire team duo Scarface and Cordelia, like together, like they are the special duo, or is it just special fire team duo?
So the way it's coming down from from the war trader and whatever.
Yeah.
The way it's coming down is her rule that says can join any fire team trumps the wording of the special fire team.
Wait, no, I'm down with that. And it just kicks one of them out.
Yeah, when the Army first came out, when Army first updated with the sectorial, neither Scarface nor Cordelia had duo on their profile.
I see.
And so it was like, well, no, of course she can't join it because the only thing it says is special duo. These two, neither one of them has duo, so neither one can form a fire team without the other one. Well, then they updated it, and now they each have duo on their profiles. Well, so you could run Valeria and Cordelia, or Valeria and Scarface.
I like that. I like your assessment to that better, too, because then he has hacker defense if people try to come in and want to take him over. I like that.
And as he's moving up to get his, you know, range 24 Mark 12s to bear, he's also dragging Valeria along to get closer to the who's a what's it's. The
objectives.
The objectives.
Yeah. Yeah, man. Yeah.
And so now while you're moving, you don't block line of fire, but he is a big base and tall, so while stationary, he can also help protect her just by virtue of line
just
of sight.
Just standing there,
You've got to get around him to get to see her. And then we get into all the bots, right? And we are seriously running out of time. Okay. So you got the Clipper drone bot. It's got a missile launcher, or it's got a smart missile launcher. And it can be part of a Druze fire team. Or it doesn't have to be.
And there's not a ton of forward observing going on in this faction. You got the Hunzikut, you got the Pathfinder drone bot.
Yeah, I mean, the only other thing is, like, maybe with your pitchers and repeaters, like, spotlighting.
Valyria has spotlight.
Yeah.
So you could spotlight stuff for the Smart Missile Launcher, or just bring it as... The Smart Missile Launcher doesn't have a hit mode, though.
No, that's the only downside. The plus side is it doesn't have any negative zone. It's either plus three or zero. So that's cool, especially if you put Marksman on it. But you're only AP double action, not explosive. And like you said, there's no hit mode. So if somebody, it's easy to get around them because they're like, oh, I'm right by the HVT. Or I'm close to your guy, so you can't shoot. Because that blast template's going to hit those. So it's really easy around there. I was all about it until I kind of looked into that.
But the missile launcher, the not smart,
yeah,
but dumb missile launcher, you have the hit mode, so you can avoid hitting nearby. And tell you what, it's pano remotes. They're getting the good military surplus.
Yeah, they are.
In the Druze society, because ballistic skill 12. Is the Clipper 12 as well?
Yep.
And you put that in a five-man fire team, and you've got a, you know, ballistic skill 15 burst 2 missile launcher.
Yeah.
That is not a terrible ARO piece.
Not at all.
It's not even a terrible active turn piece. You know, your two dice versus their one, but you're hitting on 15s, and you're probably outranging, whatever.
Yeah, the Sierra, and Pathfinder are the only ones that are 11s, and then you have the Clipper and the Peacemaker that's 12. The Peacemaker is the one that's halfway up the board.
Yep.
With a flamethrower.
Heavy shotgun and a flamethrower bot. Or you could take the Spitfire for one SWC. And again, that's where you run into SWC techs.
It's hard for me to get the Spitfire in with everything else I want to take.
Fugazis are a legit cheapo order at 8 points that are a super fast repeater to get in position for the hackers that you can bring. Super fragile, but super cheap.
Yeah, I really, really like those ones. That's why I wanted to order another box, because I wanted to wake up with the new Fugazi.
Pathfinders are legit toolbox remotes. What's the whip on those guys? Is it Pano 12 or is it a 13?
I believe it's a 13. Yep.
So specialists that are 6-4, that have multi-terrain, they've got the whole toolbox that those forward observer bots have, sniffer and sensor and...
Satlock and all the good stuff.
So... Oh, you know what? We don't have a lot of MSV in our Druze sectorial. What am I going to do about all those camos? Well, I'm going to run my Pathfinders on the flanks and...
19s?
And go whoop, 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 whoop.
19s. Just don't roll a 20.
Reveal stuff. And especially those pesky TO camoed Oniwabans, ninjas, shinobus. Yep. Pathfinder, Clipper...
That's good.
Fugazi.
You got the Camilles. So those are your baggage.
8-point baggage bots that count as 28 points. Mm-hmm.
For minus sweepers. You have your Evo.
You got your Evo hacker that can... there's no AD, is there? There's only parachutist.
Yep. So you don't really worry about that. That doesn't even have
to upgrade. But you could do the whole bot thing where you bring all the bots that have repeaters on them and do Flash Pulsa Palooza. All the burst two.
You have a lot of repeaters.
Yep.
And not even flash pulses. Isn't the Peacemaker a repeater?
And then you've got that sweet 21.
It's a burst two shotgun.
Yeah. Then you have that sweet, sweet 21 point no SWC combi rifle mule bot. So as a baggage
piece. Total reaction repeater.
Right. As a baggage piece, it's worth 41 points in a scoring zone. And if they come to screw with it, your total reaction with that combi rifle. So,
or light shotgun, if they're really close.
Combi rifle light. Oh, yeah. Of course it is, because it's a Camille. Hashtag Hakislam.
Yeah, so if they're within eight, I'll take the two shots at the plus six.
And then Nazmats, servants for your engineers or doctors. Is the only doctor that brawler at whip 12?
Yeah.
Oy, oy, oy. Yeah,
that's pretty...
Like, they couldn't hire anyone from Hakislam to be in their whip 14?
Do you know the one I'm thinking of, right? The HID is Oh, I painted it for Bill. How can I?
So apparently neither do you remember.
Yeah, no, I can't. Why is the name slipping my
mind? I don't know
mind?
What you're talking about, so the, I can't help
the
you.
The really badass mercenary doctor that's a guy trapped in a girl's
Avicenna.
Body. Avicenna. How could Avicenna not be in here?
Isn't oh my she, gosh.
Isn't she part of Hawk? Can't yeah. you take her? You're right?
Maybe the Druze is one of the people she is
hiding from. Yeah, it could be.
And
or maybe they're like, we can't give these guys a whip 15 doctor. Is it might be Dr. Plus too.
Sierra Total Reaction Bot.
Yeah, standard.
You know, your standard yeah. availability one. Ballistic skill 11.
Yeah, it's 11.
TR bot. Like that. No mimetism because combined army's better. Mm. Are those all the remotes?
Yep.
So that just leaves us with Saito Toga.
I'll say the man himself. So when I saw this immediately, I was like, I don't like the original Saito Togan, but there is a model that came out that looks eerily similar. And if you're playing a bunch of Druze, I don't see anybody giving you a lot of crap. If you pop, the Shikami without the hat, like the one that just bald,
oh.
that looks like Saito Togan to me. So, and cool. it's themed in your army. You know, this is my Merc Force. I wanted something to look different. So that's kind of what I like.
I will use Nekadai from the Outrage box.
That's actually my option right now because I can't find a freaking Saito Togan anywhere because apparently this is...
You mean Shikami.
I mean Shikami, yeah. Can't find a Shikami anywhere because apparently they were popular and everything else in this army is popular. It's taking me forever to try to order this stuff. But what you get with him, he's 39 or 40 points. I've been finding myself putting him in when I was like, oh, I'm... either limited insertion or I can't like I kind of want that TO camo guy that's infiltrating. He has smoke grenades, so this can pair up with that MSV2 sniper.
We finally found smoke in the
yeah,
faction.
Yeah, it's the only smoke.
For how many points?
39 or 40. Ooh. If you want him to be a specialist, you have to pay 40 points. Scary thing about this, this is one of the things that I can't stand. He's armor one wound, glass cannon. So it's commitment. It is a commitment. It is your only smoke. He does have explosive close combat weapon for when that is okay. Like the grid.
Martial arts level.
Martial arts level 4. But close combat 24, so that's nice. But armor one. You have TO. Anybody with MSV is going to smoke him. So you have to be really careful with him. Not somebody you're going to want to run around and just be like, I have explosive close combat weapon and close combat 24 and martial arts and blah, blah, blah. One bullet to stop them all.
Yeah.
is what I'm saying. So like you're going to want to keep him. I'm playing super support with this guy, especially if he's a specialist. Whip 13, so it's middle of the road.
No, in this faction, it's top draw.
Well, yeah. Okay. Actually, it's true though. So it's kind of nice. But I mean, for me, if he is if you have the point, make him a specialist. Because if you have it, why not make him a specialist? Unless it's a mission where you can kill more, then well, why would I bring him as a specialist? But he really is a support piece that you're gonna have to use with some finesse. I like the smoke. Too, it'd be good to team up with Scarface to get him in range of those Mark 12s. Or maybe to hide some of your duos or hide your Haris.
Yeah,
but smoke out.
39 points, though. I'd much rather have a dude that's 5 points that can throw a smoke.
Like a mutt?
yeah.
He's hidden. I mean,
so many points.
Lots. That's his downfall.
Because you do pay for those toys like hidden deployment, mm-hmm. like close combat 24, like the explosive close combat weapon at mm-hmm. burst 2 because of the martial arts level 4. But yeah, that's a lot of points for one lucky shot. Not even lucky, just one well-played shot.
Yep, but with his TO and proper management of your terrain, he can be a cheap answer. Sorry, man, I just got somebody text me while I'm reading this.
Well,
a cheap answer for... I know, right? Cheap answer for like heavy armor. I would take him at a tag if I could get him in while he was camoed. And now you tied the tag up for the time being.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like that points trade. Well,
Sure, know? Can be fun, but so easy to just disappear.
Usually I'm looking at them if I'm doing 10 orders.
And so we've got, well, and a surprise out of nowhere. And he's so odd compared to the rest of the army.
Right.
I think the only one we missed so far is the Hunzakut.
Yeah, because we kind of briefly just brushed over that she was the only forward observer.
Yeah, the only, like, camo infiltrating specialist, like, Saito, you can take the specialist operative.
Yeah.
But she's great. Mines, irregular, but that's okay, because she's going to be going around doing stuff, pushing buttons, and laying mines.
Deployable repeater. So, again,
your hacking coverage
of this is ridiculous.
And so, more on her on all the back Hawk Islam episodes. Here she is of special importance because we always love those camo infiltrating specialists, and she is really the only one that you get in Bayram Security. So,
other than the expensive Saito-kun,
those are our thoughts about stuff and how some of it fits together with other stuff. Let us know your thoughts and what you've been theorizing or experimenting with since this army has dropped. Next week, we'll come back. We'll have we each made a list, and we've each made dozens of lists, but we each printed out a list for tonight that we're not going to get to. But we'll come back next week to talk about those and how it all fits together and what we envision it doing and how it gets stuff done.
Conversation can serve no purpose anymore. Goodbye.
So that's going to do it for episode 163. Happy Druze year. And thank you for listening. We look forward to hearing your thoughts and your excitement about the new Druze. And next week, we'll come back to you with our Druze army lists. And that's going to do it. Congratulations, Kip.
Thank you, sir.
On having sex with your wife. Good job.
Nice. I want to congratulate our MasterGlass winners, Tor and Joaquin.
Yeah, guys. Great job.
I messed his name up
again. And they just, like, they stick in your head.
Yeah.
There are such good entries. Like, you just find myself thinking about them at odd times. And so that's how you know they're good. So congratulations, guys. And to everybody who entered, thank you for participating. Remember, next quarter's theme is Druze. Anything from the sectorial.
Yep.
Go nuts. Do what you like. Can't wait to see all your color schemes. That's going to be my favorite part.
Likewise.
And until then, as long as you are able to, make sure you get out there and support your local game stores.
Find out how you can support the show, go to patreon.com/MayaCast.
You can find us online at www.MayaCast.com.
We are on Facebook at facebook.com/InfinityMayaCast.
Follow at MayaPodcast on Twitter.
Join the MayaCast forum group on Facebook.
And as always, you can email us at tom@mayacast.com.
And Kip@mayacast.com.